Alright, y'all, so I've been gone for a little minute, but I'm back. Now, this video right here, I'm breaking down how the government was behind Hurricane Katrina and how they came after our people on purpose. Like, Hurricane Katrina was done on purpose, and it was something that wasn't a mistake or just nature taking place. It was actually something that was done on purpose. But one of the biggest things that I want to get on and actually speak on, too, is because we know we got Jacob's Trouble coming. We got martial law, pretty much, like, when they coming for the real people of the book. Us as being African Americans, us as being black people, they coming for us because they really know that we are really the true children of Israel. Now, this happened in 2005, but they planning on doing something similar like that real soon with a pretty much like a red flag attack. Because, you know, they got a machine that can control the weather. They got a machine called the Heart Machine. It control the weather. And they pretty much been doing this for a minute. This was back in 2005, and they did this back in 2005, so... Yeah, they most definitely got some more plans to try to do something, but the most I ain't gonna let it rock, though. So, yeah, this video is just basically breaking down how the government was behind Hurricane Katrina. And everybody know that New Orleans at the time was an all-black city, similar to, like, the city I live in Atlanta. But New Orleans was, like, pretty much, like, an all-black city at the time. And they did this specifically in a black neighborhood. So, yeah, let's get to it.
Changed dramatically, tragically, and perhaps irreversibly. There's now over 25 feet of water where there was once city streets and thriving neighborhoods.
I hate the way they portray us in the media. If you see a black family, it says they're looting. See a white family, it says they're looking for food. And you know it's been 5 days because most of the people are black. And even for me to complain about, I would be a hypocrite because I've tried to turn away from the teacher TV because it's too hard to watch. I've even been shopping before even giving a donation. So now I'm calling my business manager right now to see what is the biggest amount I can give. And just to imagine if I was down there, and those are my people down there. So anybody out there that wants to do anything that we can help with the setup, the way America is set up to help the poor, the black people, the less well off as slow as possible. I mean, this is Red Cross is doing everything they can. We already realize a lot of the people that could help are at war right now, fighting another way, and they've given them permission to go down and shoot us.
And subtle, but in even many ways more profoundly devastating, is the lasting damage to the survivors' will to rebuild and remain in the area. The destruction of the spirit of the people of southern Louisiana and Mississippi may end up being the most tragic loss of all.
George Bush doesn't care about black people.
Please call.
In the past few days.
Good evening. I'm speaking to you from the city of New Orleans. Nearly empty, still partly underwater, and waiting for life and hope to return. Eastward from Lake Pontchartrain, across the Mississippi coast, to Alabama and into Florida, millions of lives were changed in a day by a cruel and wasteful storm. And all who question the future of the Crescent City need to know. There is no way to imagine America without New Orleans, and this great city will rise again.
Attention on the flight deck.
When communities are rebuilt, they must be even better and stronger than before the storm. Within the Gulf region are some of the most beautiful and historic places in America. As all of us saw on television, there's also some deep, persistent poverty in this region as well. That poverty has roots in a history of racial discrimination, which cut off generations from the opportunity of America. We have a duty to confront this poverty with bold action. So let us restore all that we have cherished from yesterday, and let us rise above the legacy of inequality. Four years after the frightening experience of September the 11th, Americans have every right to expect a more effective response in a time of emergency. When the federal government fails to meet such an obligation, I, as president, am responsible for the problem and for the solution. So I've ordered every cabinet secretary to participate in a comprehensive review of the government response to the hurricane. I know that when you sit on the steps of a porch where a home once stood, or sleep on a cot in a crowded shelter, it is hard to imagine a bright future. But that future will come. The streets of Biloxi and Gulfport will again be filled with lovely homes and the sound of children playing. The churches of Alabama will have their broken steeples mended and their congregations whole. And here in New Orleans, the streetcars will once again rumble down St. Charles, and the passionate soul of a great city will return.
I guess somebody was putting out some bad news that it was totally unsafe. It's not unsafe to come in here and help these people. No water, no ice, no sea rashes, nothing for the last 4 days. Dead people around the walls of the convention center laying in the middle of the street. Babies, two babies dehydrated and died. I just tell you, I couldn't take it.
They won't let them walk out of there because I'm standing right above that convention center. And what they've done is they've locked them in there. The government said, you go here and you'll get help. Or you go in that Superdome and you'll get help. And they didn't get help. They got locked in there and they watched people being killed around them. And they watched people starving and they watched elderly people not get any medicine. And now they know it's happening because we've been telling them repeatedly over and over every day.
Well, when Denise Moore finally made her way out of New Orleans, she had been at the convention center, she was surprised to see the coverage.
I kept hearing the word animal, and I didn't see animals. We were trapped like animals, but I saw the greatest humanity I've ever seen from the most unlikely places.
Denise Moore eventually ended up at the convention center with her mom, her niece, and her niece's two-year-old daughter. But the day before the storm, because Denise's mom worked at Memorial Hospital in New Orleans, and because hospital employees are allowed to stay there during hurricanes, all of them went to the hospital. They were given a room to stay in, but later they were kicked out of the room for two white nurses.
Yeah, so I got really mad,
mm-hmm.
You know, so I went home. And so went to the house. I set up my twin bed in the hallway. The hallway supposedly structurally is the best place to be if the building's going to be moving around if there's high wind.
Mm-hmm.
And good thing I did. Somewhere around 5:00 in the morning, I jumped up out of bed. The ceiling started crashing down around me. I was riding that bed like a horse. I was so scared. I had never been that scared for that long. We lived on the second floor, so I was scared it was going to fall through. That even in the hallways, that the building was swaying so much that I'd fall through the floor and end up injured down there and nobody would find me. And next thing I know, the water is pouring through the ceiling. I was like, well, and people were calling on the phone. You should have stayed at the hospital. It was ridiculous. I was just scared, fearing for my life for 8 full hours. My heart was in my throat. I was like, oh, no, when this is over, I'm coming back to the hospital. And so I went back to the hospital.
Can I ask you before you tell what happens next, why not just evacuate?
Well, first of all, my mom is essential personnel, so she couldn't leave. I don't have a car, so I couldn't leave. My niece was going to go with her mother, but we didn't want them to get trapped on the highway in the storm with the baby.
Mm-hmm.
So we thought it would be safer to just stay at the hospital because we rode out the last hurricane at home, but we sent my niece to the hospital with her baby.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's just been the way it goes. The hospital was the safest place to be if you were going to stay in the city.
So you walk back to the hospital, and what do you find there?
Well, there's a lot of people roaming around with their kids, and we're sharing food, and we're having a good old time, just waiting for a chance to go back home.
Mm-hmm.
Then the levees broke. And the next morning, I was able to go back to the house because I wanted to pick up my degrees. I earned them. I wanted to make sure they weren't wet. And frankly, I was looking for a carton of cigarettes that I knew was in that house somewhere.
And so did you find the cigarettes?
I found the cigarettes.
And were they dry?
And I found my degrees, and I grabbed my vital papers, my Social Security card. None of that was wet because it was in a little purse. And I brought my vital papers back to the hospital, and my mom and Sydney were going to go back to the house to go get theirs. But the water started rising. So within a couple of hours, you weren't able to get back to the house. You know, it just kept rising. We thought, okay, now we're trapped in here, and we don't know how high this water's going to get. So it finally covered the basement, so the generators went out. Covered the first floor.
And when you say covered the first floor, was it actually coming inside the hospital building?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the heartbreaking thing was watching them turn people away who had waded through that water to get to the hospital for safe haven. It was amazing. It was heartbreaking.
How often did you see that?
You know, that happened over and over again. The person who sticks out most in my mind is a man who had his wife and his two children, and his baby and his daughter were so dehydrated. The people were yelling at him, you can't come in here. And so the people, we were on the smoking patio, which is on the second floor, and so we saw them, and we were yelling at him, man, leave the baby, man, leave the baby. And he was like, I can't leave my baby. We don't have a house. How am I going to find my baby if I leave him with you? I don't know where you're going to take him. And been in this water for 2 days. And, you know, it was devastating to just see that. And then we knew that nobody was going to be able to come up in there. And so the people on the smoking balcony, we would, like, throw them water. And we'd try to throw them food. And
where'd they send him to?
I don't know. We don't know where he went. But I did find out later that they were letting in people with gunshot wounds and snake bites. So it wasn't like they turned everybody away. It was just that I guess they were thinking, we got 3,000 people in this hospital we have to evacuate. We cannot take on any more responsibility, you know.
Yeah.
So I understood why they had to turn them away. It was just heartbreaking to see.
Yeah. So you were in the hospital until, and there's no power in the hospital, but there's water, and it sounds like there's food, too.
We didn't have water after that first night.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we ran out of everything, you know, because people were sharing with each other, and we just thought we'd be able to go home in a minute.
Yeah.
That's the thing. It's like you survived the hurricane. I was a happy camper because I had been more scared than I had ever been in my life, and I walked out of there, you know, so who knew?
So how long were you in the hospital? How many days? When did you get out?
2 days, and then we were transported to that corner. And what we heard is that we were going to be dropped off by boat to a corner, and the buses would pick us up, and we would be heading to Texas. That's what we were told.
And then the buses come, and they take you where?
It wasn't buses. It was the police had to commandeer vehicles. They were asking people in the crowd if they knew how to drive trucks and buses. They were stealing them. The police had to steal vehicles. And so it was totally different than what we anticipated.
They're just taking any random, like, truck and hot-wiring
buses.
It?
Yeah.
And so what was the vehicle that you got to the next place in? Like, what were you in?
There was a key and lock van.
Right, locksmith.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That happened to be driving around, and the police made him start taking us.
And then you go to where?
We go to the convention center. And when we arrived, there were people all on the street under the bridge. And we were like, why are these people on the street? Why aren't they in the convention center? And when we got there, people were saying, you don't want to go in there.
Did you go inside at all?
Not until the next day.
What'd you see?
Inside?
Yeah.
A sewer. A sewer, literally. Because I had to use the bathroom. And I was like, where's the bathroom? So I went inside. The whole place was a bathroom. Stepping in feces, stepping in urine, all over the carpets. I mean, I used to work at the convention center. That was hard to see. It was a beautiful building. And it was a toilet. And people were sitting close as they could to the doors, but the smell was overwhelming.
So like, then what do you do? Like, what's the best you can do?
I actually stopped eating the minute we got there. I wouldn't eat or drink anything. Because I figured if you don't put nothing in, nothing's coming out. I was in the Army. But yeah. Even at that, I still had to use the bathroom. It was ridiculous. So what I ended up doing was getting a cop, going behind a partition, having a guy guard me while I was relieving myself in a cup behind some partition in the convention center.
Yeah.
And I got all kind of stuff on my feet. Thank God it started raining because I have a really sensitive nose. I was sitting down and I could smell a crap on my feet.
And where'd y'all sleep?
We slept on the sidewalk. This place, there was trash all over the ground outside. And I was thinking, how are the girls going to even lay down with their babies? There's not a spot that's clean. Nothing. Mm-hmm. There's nowhere to lay down.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And then what my mom wanted me to make sure I tell you, what they kept doing the whole time was tell us to line up for the buses that never came. It was like they were doing drills every 4 hours. You all have to line up for the bus, and if you bum rush the bus, they're just going to take off without you, and nobody's going to get to go anywhere. You have to line up. You have to be in a straight line. We're talking about old people in wheelchairs and women with babies in lines waiting for buses that you know goddamn well aren't coming. Like they were playing with us. I figured it out early in the morning, but what am I supposed to do, make an announcement? The buses aren't coming. And so I walked up to the so-called head guy in charge of our section, and I told him, I said, why do you have these people sitting out here in this sun? And you know these buses aren't coming. The buses are coming. I said, you're just playing with us. Who gives you the authority to keep lining us up like this, to stand in this heat? He was like, well, I know the guy who can make the call for the buses. I said, well, why hasn't he called them? People are dying. He said, I wish I could tell you what you wanted to hear. I said, I want to hear the truth. Are the buses coming or not? We need to get these old people and these babies out of this heat. And then he just walked away. And we were left there without help, without food, without water, without sanitary conditions, as if it's perfectly all right for these animals to reside in a freaking sewer like rats. Because there was nothing but black people back there.
Yeah.
Disposable. And then the story became, they left us here to die. They're going to kill us.
You mean that's what people were saying to each other?
Yeah.
And is that what you believed?
I was almost convinced.
That basically...
Because I kept having a vision of them opening that floodgate on us.
Mm-hmm.
Of my niece and her baby floating away from me screaming.
Hmm.
And I just knew it. And then the next morning... I heard from somebody that they actually were going to open that floodgate. So by the time the rumor started that the National Guard was going to kill us, and I almost halfway believed it.
And so people were saying basically they just brought us here, they're going to leave us here to die?
Yeah, that's what we thought.
Why can't some of the Chinook helicopters and Blackhawks that we have heard flying over for days and days and days simply lower pallets of water, meals ready to eat, medical supplies right into downtown New Orleans?
You see, there are so many babies here. It's just not, I mean, it's not, you know, I it's not a question of objectivity. It's a question of reality. This is the, you, how do you, I don't know, man. I don't, let them walk out of here. Let them walk the hell out of here. Let them get on that interstate and walk out, walk someplace, walk to the Walmart on the other side of the river, walk to some other town, walk someplace where you can help them. All you got here is thousands and thousands of people who have desperate, desperate needs 6 days later. These people in the same clothes. Where do you think they're going to the bathroom? What the hell?
The police kept passing us by. And the National Guard kept passing us by with their guns pointed at us. And because they wouldn't, when you see a truck full of water and people have been crying for water for a day and a night, and the water truck passes you by, just keeps going, how are we supposed to believe these people were here to help us? It was almost like they were taunting us. And then don't forget, they kept lining us up for buses that never showed up.
Yeah.
We thought they were playing with us, and that best case scenario, and in worst case scenario, they wanted us to either kill each other or die. Or they were going to kill us.
So we keep hearing in the news about violence inside the convention center and people getting killed and women being raped. Did you know about any of that when you were there?
The convention center is section A through J, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
We were about at H. But where we are was mostly old people and women with children, and I didn't see anybody get raped. I did see people die. I saw one man die, and I saw a girl and her baby die. But I didn't see anybody getting hurt.
And talk about, now, there were men just kind of like roaming with guns, packs of men, and just...
They
just...
were securing the area. Criminals. These guys were criminals. They were, you know.
Yeah.
But somehow these guys got together, figured out who had guns, and decided they were going to make sure that no women were getting raped, because we did hear about the women getting raped in the Superdome, and, you know, that nobody was hurting babies, and nobody was hurting these old people. They were the ones getting juice for the babies. They were the ones getting clothes for people who had walked through that water. They were the ones fanning the old people, because that's what moves the guys, the gangster guys, the most. The plight of the old people. That's what haunts me the most, seeing those old people sitting in them chairs and not being able to get up and walk around or nothing.
And so these were just guys from the neighborhood. What else were they doing?
They started looting on St. Charles and Napoleon, and there was a Rite Aid there, and they, you know, you would think that they would be stealing stuff that, you know, fun stuff or whatever, because it's a free city according to them, right? But they were taking juice for the baby, water, beer for the older people, food, raincoats so that they could all be seen, you know, by each other and stuff. And, you know, I thought it was pretty cool and very well organized.
And did you see this yourself? These guys,
yeah,
go,
I was right there.
And so basically they went off to this Rite Aid, they got the stuff, they brought it back and started distributing it?
Mm-hmm.
Like Robin Hood.
Yeah, exactly like Robin Hood. And that's why I got so mad, because they're calling these guys animals. These guys.
It's clear he specifically said for us to shoot looters.
That's what got to me. Because I know what they did.
Yeah.
You calling these people animals? You know, come on. And I saw what they did, and I was really touched by it, and I liked the way that they were organized about it and that they were thoughtful about it, because they had families they couldn't find, too.
Yeah.
You know, and that they would put themselves out like that on other people's behalf.
Yeah.
You know, I never had a real high opinion of thugs myself, but I tell you one thing, I'll never look at them the same way again.
Why didn't people just walk away? That's what I don't understand.
Couldn't we weren't just... allowed. The police, people kept trying to go up the bridge so they could go to Algiers, and they'd be turned away, and they'd be sent back down.
And literally, they would just, like, go a couple streets away and somebody would send them back?
They'd go up the bridge.
Right.
To go across to the West Bank where it was dry.
Right.
And lights were on, you know, and the National Guard was up there with guns. They turned them back with guns, and the governor gave orders to shoot to kill. You couldn't get through them.
Yeah.
So people would go up the bridge. Every time they lined us up for the buses, and the buses wouldn't come, people in groups would go up the bridge trying to get across the river. People who had family across the river couldn't get across the river. They were not letting us out of there. They wasn't letting nobody in. So we were trapped. I can't even express it. The tears get close to my eyes, and I have this feeling in the pit of my stomach, like if I start crying, the sobs will kill me. I guess someday it'll calm down, and I'll be able to just cry like a normal person, but I feel like if I started crying, I'd never stop.
Denise Moore, she's now in Baton Rouge. She's okay. She's just found a new job there.
If it keeps on raining, love is going to break. If it keeps on raining, love is going to break. And the water gonna come, and I have no place to stay.
Joining us to talk about this is Greg Palast. Greg Palast is a BBC investigative reporter, and he investigated for Democracy Now! The real causes behind Hurricane Katrina in a film called Big Easy to Big Empty. Thank you for joining us, Greg.
Glad to be with you.
So, Greg, what is the connection between this 50th anniversary of the March on Washington and the 8th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina?
Plenty. For those who know Greg Palast as an investigative reporter, most people know that I uncovered that Catherine Harris knocked tens of thousands of people off the voter rolls of Florida in the 2000 election, thereby handing the election to George Bush. People were illegally called felons when their only crime was voting while black. It was an ethnic cleansing of the voter rolls. When Martin Luther King stood up before the Washington Monument 50 years ago this week, he said, "I have a dream that black folk in Alabama and Mississippi and in the South will be able to cast a ballot." Well, 50 years later, we're still asking that question. Of course, we've eliminated the white sheets and the Ku Klux Klan as a threat. It's now spreadsheets and ethnic cleansing. Now, I did the investigation of the ethnic cleansing of the voter rolls of Florida. And by the way, that spread to Louisiana and Georgia. But I also look at the ethnic cleansing of another town, New Orleans, for Democracy Now. And what I found was just stunning. You have to put these two things together. You have to put the ethnic cleansing of the voter rolls of Florida together with the ethnic cleansing that happened and is going on in New Orleans and Louisiana with Hurricane Katrina just a cover, an excuse. That's all it is. And what you get away, take away from this is that King's dream was announced 50 years ago, but 8 years ago in New Orleans is when the dream drowned. And here's what I mean. I've discovered that Louisiana State University's Hurricane Center sent an emergency request to the White House more than a year before the levees broke, before Katrina. And Dr. Ivor von Heerden, the deputy of the Hurricane Center, contacted George Bush's senior counsel at the White House in a long discussion. He said, "New Orleans is going to drown. Not maybe, not will. We don't even need a hurricane." Remember, and by the way, Hurricane Katrina never touched New Orleans. It went 30 miles east. It was simply a storm surge. He said, "We cannot handle even a storm surge in New Orleans. The levees are too low. The levees are built wrong. And not only that, but you've built a canal for the oil companies, which is bringing the Gulf of Mexico right to our doorstep. This city is going to drown unless you bring in the Army Corps of Engineers to correct this." But the Army Corps of Engineers, remember, in 2004, was in Iraq. They weren't there for the American people. They were there, you know, to blow up bridges and then rebuild them over the Tigris River. So what happened is that all the warnings of Dr. von Heerden, and I got to tell you, it's not like these were secret things. British television, where I work for BBC TV, 30 days before New Orleans drowned, just 30 days, von Heerden said on British television, "This city could be underwater in a month." Exactly 30 days later, it was underwater. This was not some shock and some surprise. Now, what does this have to do with Martin Luther King and the rights of African Americans to life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness, and democracy? Okay, life and liberty was lost. If this was somewhere else, if this was not an African-American city, an overwhelmingly African-American city, it would have been protected. I'm speaking to you right now from near West Hampton Beach, which is where the movie stars go for the summer and the real estate brokers and the venture capitalists and financial vultures hang out for the summer. This area was wiped out by a hurricane twice. And both times, the United States federal government evacuated people, took responsibility. No one's ever hurt here in this rich beach area. Bill Clinton's just down the road. He's, you know, he doesn't even get his flip-flops wet when there's a hurricane. And furthermore, every single house here, and I'm not, when I say houses, I mean mansions, these beach mansions, every one of them was replaced by the federal government at the public cost, even with hundreds of truckloads of sand brought in so that the venture capitalists and the Democratic Party donors could get their tans. What happened in New Orleans? I got to tell you, according to a United States federal court judgment, von Heerden was correct. There was something called the Mississippi River Gulf Outlet Canal, which created basically a highway for the water surge from Katrina, a highway for that surge. It was insane. It was just an invitation for a tidal wave. There was never a hurricane, but there was a tidal wave that hit New Orleans, which knocked over those levees. It was the responsibility of the federal government. And the only reason the federal government did that, by the way, built this stupid canal, which basically drowned New Orleans. It was a shotgun rifle. It was like a rifle barrel pointed right at the city. It was because oil companies wanted to save time. They didn't want to take the Mississippi River all the way to the Gulf, which winds all the way around. You know, the Old Man River goes in all kinds of crazy curves. So they built a straight canal for the oil tankers, so the oil tankers could save a day or two on travel down to the Gulf. That's what it was all about. So just oil tankers could save a day or two. The city of New Orleans drowned. The federal courts determined that's exactly what happens. That's the science of it, and ordered the federal government to rebuild the homes of the African Americans who lost their homes because this was something that was done by the oil companies and the federal government. That's a court ruling. But the federal government, if it loses a court case, cannot be required to pay unless Congress agrees and appropriates the money, unless the president asks. Barack Obama never asked for a dime to rebuild the homes that were lost, the people of the city of New Orleans. Yes, he rebuilt the homes of all the movie stars in West Hampton, but not a single home in the city of New Orleans. I want to repeat that. The federal government has never rebuilt any homes for the people of the city of New Orleans. They gave them formaldehyde-filled trailers. They spread them all over the country, and they drowned them. Not only were 2,000 people drowned by this horrific negligence, willful negligence of the federal government, when they knew in advance this would happen.
Well, Greg, let's talk about the reconstruction and the recovery effort in New Orleans. And specifically, let's talk about the African-American community and how fared. What has it been like for them down there post-Katrina?
Horrific. I got to tell you, look, this was, as far as the Caucasian and elite leadership of New Orleans, that's both black and white. Remember that when we talk about there's no African-American community in New Orleans, just so you know. There is an elite black community, which is from the old Creole community, which includes, by the way, the old black slaveholders. There are a lot of black people who owned slaves in the New Orleans area before the Civil War. And you have that old black elite and the old white elite, and then you have the average African-American who worked those plantations and lived in places like the Lower Ninth Ward, which, by the way, had the highest concentration of African-American home ownership in America until Katrina. What happened was all these people were shipped out, put on buses, not even told where they were going, and sent to Texas, sent to Baltimore, sent all over, and sent to Florida. No way to return, no plan to return. People weren't allowed to return to their own homes, not even allowed to put trailers on their own property. Not allowed. So when we talk about New Orleans recovering in the sense of like it's up to 70-80% of its original pre-flood population, that's not the same people. They're gone. Half of the African-American population in New Orleans is gone forever, dispersed. They don't have the money or the ability to get back. They don't have their homes back. They don't have the ability to get back. And so in terms of work, almost all the work of reconstruction was done by people who came in from Salvador and from Latin America, cheap labor, and then the technical labor came from the north. So basically, it was all carpetbag labor, and local African-Americans lost their jobs. In our film, which, by the way, if you go to gregpalace.com, you can download it for free this week, Big Easy to Big Empty. You'll see that we had a young black man who stood on a bridge for 4 days while helicopters flew over, ignoring him and the people he was with. A grandfather near him gave his last bottle of water to his grandchildren, and then he died of dehydration on that bridge. Then Stephen was put on a bus, separated from his family. He never saw his children and his wife for weeks. He had no idea where they were shipped off to. And then he was dumped in Texas. He ended up taking a job in Texas and his job at the Marriott Hotel in New Orleans was taken over by immigrant workers who would be willing to work non-union and at half his pay. So you had basically the construction work was done almost entirely by immigrant workers as opposed to the black population which had lived there. So basically the black population was cleansed out of the city and off the voter rolls. So that you actually don't forget, this is also another way to get rid of to use a natural disaster as a cover to, in effect, cleanse the voter rolls as well. The state went from Democratic governor to Republican, Bobby Jindal. Altogether, the New Orleans went from a black city to a white and Latin American city. It's, you know, it's a very different city than it was.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for joining us, Greg.
You're very welcome.